Welcome and hello from Berlin, and welcome to the next episode of the Quintessential Tuesdays with Dr. Chris. We are very happy to be live with you again today, and we're looking forward to a great time of education. Today we have the great pleasure of welcoming Dr. Ronaldo Hirata from New York at the moment. He will speak to us about the recipes for composite restorations and his new publication. Chris, I'd like you to join me to welcome the people as well. So we are very happy to be here once again with you all and share the time. Very important. It's gin o'clock, so we have a drink with you all. And just a little housekeeping. Please remember to drink when you share, to use the Q&A tool to ask your questions. We will try to answer them after the lecture together with Ronaldo. And yeah, Chris, please.
Yes, hello to everyone. That's nice to have you back here. Today it's a surprise webinar for me because Ronaldo Hirata will be our guest today. And it's the first time in this webinar series I don't know the guy personally. But when Christian gave me his book, and the book is called Recipes and will be launched, I think, in summer, I was on fire. He looked at his, then I looked to his Instagram account, and I can tell you I'm not doing very much in Instagram and I'm not following very many people, but I saw him and I recognized a little bit of myself. I used to do Kung Fu when I was working in Munich, and I love skateboarding since I was a little boy, and I still am doing it. And what do I see on his Instagram account? He's a passionate skateboarder and martial arts fighter. And he does what he does with ambition. Take a look at his book and you know what I'm talking about. Today, it's a little bit like Christmas for me. I think I know what I get, but I'm excited like a speedboat. So I will not lose any more time. And so Ronaldo, please show us all what passion and composite dentistry is.
Thank you, appreciate. So it's gonna be a pleasure to stay for 2 hours with you guys. Right now I'm in New York. Right now is lunchtime, 12:30. So we'll begin with the presentation, and after that we can ask some questions that we open for discussion. I think that is pretty good. Seems good?
That's so very good.
Is working, and then we go from here. So I think that we can start basically, and before any information, and I think that before I begin the videos and the introduction of the lecture, I think that you can take a print screen or a picture of this slide. And most of the products, or almost all the products that I will be discussing during this lecture, they are here. And many times you don't have time enough to write down the name of the manufacturer or the information. And maybe if you take a look here, you're gonna find that. So most of the products are here. And I think that many times the professors, they are very afraid of saying what kind of product or the name of the product. But I believe that as a clinician, pretty much is what we expect to know. What is the brand that you are using in this case and stuff. So I think that you can take a print screen and then we begin the lecture. Seems good.
Gonna fight them all. Seven Nation Army couldn't hold me back. They're gonna rip it off, taking their time right behind my back. And I'm talking to myself at night because I can't forget. Back and forth through my mind behind a cigarette, and the message message coming from my eyes says, leave it alone. Don't want to hear about it. Every single one's got a story to tell. Everyone knows about it. From the Queen of England to the House of Home. And if I catch you coming back my way, I'm gonna sell it to you. And that ain't what you want to hear, but that's what I'll do. And the feeling's coming from my bones, it says find a home. I'm gonna wait you die, far from this upper for forevermore. I'm gonna work the straw, make the sweat drip out of every pore. And I'm bleeding and I'm bleeding and I'm bleeding right before the Lord. All the words are gonna bleed from me and I will sing no more. And the sting's coming from my blood, it tells me go back.
So I think that we will be talking a little bit about composites, but pretty much the idea of the book, and I think that the book is going to be launched in 2-3 months, is focused on giving recipes of restorations. And I believe that in the beginning of my profession is something that I was always looking for. Seems foolish, but if you think about the clinicians, this is something that they expect. What kind of products they need, what is the amount of each product, and how they use the product. So the book is gonna be discussing many recipes for different situations or different restorations. Right now I'm in New York, this is our lab. Right now I am in the lab and we run some research on composites and ceramics. You see the fatigue machines and micro CT, and basically this is the New York environment. But part of the time I still have my clinic in Brazil, my private clinic. My clinic is in the south of Brazil. The name of the city is Curitiba. And I still have this clinical point of view. So basically this is a combination that explains what I really do. I teach, I do research, but I still have my clinic. First of all, I will introduce the topic talking about composites. And I think that we have been discussing composites for a long time. Basically what I feel is that we are making more steps and we are planning too much. And maybe we are becoming a very, very good specialist on planning and not so good in execution, and different from before. If you remember in the past, we used to execute a lot and plan not that much, but nowadays is the opposite. I guess that we are sometimes planning too much and many times we are not executing as perfectly as we plan. And I think, and I believe that many times and many situations we can deal and we can promote a solution in a very easy and fast way. And sometimes when I say easy and fast way, people think that this is something that is too simple or is not something that we have to discuss anymore. We are so excited about technologies and different new options that we always think about huge cases, but in the day-to-day, you will realize in your private clinic that most of our problems and most of the clinical situations that we face are simple situations. and we still have difficulty dealing with simple situations. We are planning too much, we're making too much appointments, and most of the problems that we have, they are very simple. And we have to remember again how to deal with this problem in a simple way. I will give you one example. People are so addicted nowadays to WhatsApp and making a silicone index in order to reproduce with composite what you are waxing up before, that most of the newer generations, they have no idea how to restore a tooth without the index. And this is something that is something that we have to discuss from dental school. But this is a type of matrix, an index, that I think that is good, because there is no need for you to do a second appointment. There is no need for you to do a walk-up. You just do the impression of the patient. You make a draw or the perfect shape of the tooth that you desired. And at the same time that you have the patient with the broken teeth, you produce an index we call BRB matrix. It was published before by some friend of us from Brazil. And this is a way to get a very fast silicone index instead of making a WhatsApp before and then trying to reproduce this with composite. The name of the matrix is BRB. And in this way, at the same time that you made the impression of the patient is waiting in the chair, you are able to reproduce right now with composites. And also composites, we will feel that they are much more simple than before. And it has to be. So I think that we spend too much time with this artistic view of composite, and I believe that it is artistic, but in the end, I think that the technique has to be simple in order to be understood by the clinicians. And nowadays, most of the composite systems and the brands, they are thinking about a more simple way to restore these. Is essential. There's a composite from GC that is very simple. So you have some colors, some denting colors or some denting shades, some enamel shades, and that's it. There's no much, there's not too much options of composites. So you don't have too many problems in order to execute composite. And in this case, I just did the index, the silicone index, in the moment that I got a patient. We are restoring the tooth using two shades. This is just two shades of essential composite. This is medium denting and light enamel, period. And I just did a finishing and polishing. So I believe that we have to look for a simple way to restore. We have to stop becoming this type of procedure too much complex and with too much steps. I think that we are planning too much in cases that is unnecessary, especially single tooth. This is something that we have to learn from nowadays. We have to simplify sometimes some procedures, and we have to understand that this kind of procedure is our day-to-day. It's 80% of our private clinic nowadays. So this is pretty much my idea for composite. So introducing this idea of composite restorations, we can understand better what it is. We have been using composite for a long time. We've been using it for the last 30 something years. And we have some results that we know the outcome of this. I will begin with these simple situations or simple restorations. And this is pretty much what the book will offer us. You can see that this is a very typical recipe for restoration. And you see the ingredients of the composite restoration that I need. So what do I need? Phosphoric acid, I need adhesive. I have one droplet of specific stain. I need this color of composite. I need one droplet of something else. And you see that is a very step-by-step ingredients. And also I will provide what are the instruments that you need for that. I understand that is personal, but the book is personal. So I'm gonna tell you what I prefer to use. And then you're gonna see that you have the ingredients, you have the instruments that are needed, and I will show you how to execute. So pretty much the book is mainly focused on the recipes of restoration. Let me begin with the simple situations and then we begin the discussion on composite, okay? The regular way to restore a posterior teeth, we know from a long time, is basically using three layers. This is the traditional way. I begin with the dentin or opaque layer. I use a very saturated layer of dentin. And I have to leave a space of 2.5 millimeter for the next two layers. I have a way to control this next 2.5 thickness that I have to leave because I have an instrument called 2630 from Cosmedent. And the size of this ball of the burnisher is exactly 2.5 millimeter. That means I have exactly the space that I need. After that, I polymerize, I go for the second layer, and the second layer has to be a chromatic enamel. And this chromatic enamel shade is always one shade less than the dentin. And after I finish this second layer that is chromatic enamel, I have to leave a space of 1.3 millimeter thickness for the last layer. And I'm able to control this thickness because I have another instrument called M1 from Cosmedent. And the size of the tip of this M1 is exactly 1.3 millimeter. So I can control and I can leave the perfect space for the last layer. And the last layer is always gonna be achromatic enamel layer. That is the final layer. And then I just follow the basic design that I had created in the second layer. And all the stains and all the things that I want to use, I'm willing to use, I have to use before the second and the last layer for this regular traditional technique. And then when I finish the final layer and the final cusps, you can see that I'm using an instrument from Japan. The name of this kit is Tsurugi from Professor Aoshima. And also I'm using a lot the Explorer and I'm finishing the sculpture. After that, I can just seal the very deep circles that I have in the end of the sculpture with a sealant from Bisco that is called Biscover LV. And then we finish. This is a traditional way that we have been doing for the last 30 years. Let me take an old case and then we discuss from here, right? This is a class two composite that I did at that time with, in the beginning of the self-etching adhesive systems. The name of this system that I was using was Adhese from Ivoclar. And at this time, we didn't use the phosphoric acid for the enamel etching. We just used the self-etching adhesive. And then you can see that I'm finishing this restoration with the three layers that I told you before. And then I show you in the video. But pretty much I'm using the same thicknesses. Remember that I told you that after the dentin shade or the dentin layer, you have to leave a space of 2.5 millimeter. And the way to control that is this instrument that is called 2630 from Cosmedent. And after the first layer, I do the second layer. The second layer has to be a chromatic enamel, one shade less than the dentin. And then I have to leave a space of 1.3 millimeter thickness that I can control because I have this another instrument that is called M1 from Cosmedent. And then I make the basic design of the circus. I use these things that I wanna use and then I finish the last layer always with the achromatic enamel doing cuspid by cuspid. And then I told you that we can leave the principal circles in a very deep way. We just have to seal after that with the surface sealant. I told you that I used the Biscover LV. This I did years ago. At that time was when Ivoclar was introducing the adhesive. And this is the old Tetrix ceramic. But let's check this restoration years after. This is before after, of course. This is 1 year after. I can feel on the distal part that I have some abrasion on the surface. I can see better the interface as well. let's check the 3 years follow-up. 3 years after, we can see that the first lower molar, always you have more occlusal forces, especially on the distal part. That's why we have so many fractures and crack formation on the distal box of the first lower molar. But in this case, I can see that I have more abrasion on the distal part. This is 3 years after. And you know what is interesting? That the papers tells us that most of the problems, they come in the first 5 years. So this paper basically is discussing clinical evaluation. And then you can see that deterioration within the first year and later up to 5 years of function. And this is something that we face in the day-to-day. We see in our clinics that most of the problems that we have in the beginning of the restoration until 5 years. And after the fifth year, basically the result is the same. I'm gonna show you. I show you the 3 years after, let's see 8 years after. 8 years after seems pretty much like the 3 years after. I can see the abrasion, of course, on the distal, but it didn't change much from 3 years to 8 years. Let's check in the SEM. I made an impression. I did a replica of the restoration, and then on the SEM, I'm able to see the interface and also the surface. On the interface, I can see it's not a gap, but it's not perfect, of course, but I can see that the abrasion is coming on the surface composite, but I have abrasion also on the enamel. This is natural enamel. So this is something that will happen in the day to day. You have the abrasion, not only of the restoration, you have of the natural tooth. And if you check the interface, it's still sealed. You have 190 microns interface, but it's sealed. And all the papers tells us that until 250 microns, you don't need to make any repair. And this is interesting because many times in the clinic, we face this type of gap. It's kind of gap, but it's sealed. And we have this desire to make a repair. And you don't need to repair. The papers tell us you just need to repair if this gap is wider than 250 microns. So in this case, we can just keep and continue the follow-up. This is 10 years after. You can see the X-ray. Of course, you can see some staining on the surface. Surface is not perfect. Remember again that at this time, we didn't do any selective enamel etching for the self-etching. It was just the self-etching itself. Nowadays, I would make the etching of the enamel, but you can see we have some staining, but this is not infiltration. This is 12 years after. So in this way, we understood how is the aging of composite, and we understood that most of the problems comes in the first 5 years. Now, this is something that we got from our private clinic as well. What are the mainly problems that we see in restorations? Based on the literature, basically are two problems. The first problem is secondary caries. It doesn't mean that when you have a failure on the margin, you're gonna have secondary caries, of course. But secondary caries is pretty much related to failures on margin. This is the number one cause of replacement or cause of repair of composite restorations. The second one is fracture. So this is interesting to observe because the summary is the problem comes in the first 5 years. What are the problems? Usually interface and fractures is margin and fracture of restoration. So let's discuss this a little bit much. And then we got the feeling of my mainly discussion. Failures on margin is something that comes from different problems, okay? But always remember that I'm telling you about secondary caries, margin, fractures. These are the two main problems. And the two problems are coming from clinical problems and clinical procedures. We have been discussing so much dental materials. Let me say something. I am a professor of biomaterials, of dental materials, and I do research on dental materials. We do so much research, but still so far, our problems are mainly clinical. So our failures are clinical. We are discussing so much the material itself, but it's not the material. It's the clinic, it's our procedures, margin and adhesion. Our problems are margin and adhesion. Margin causing sometimes secondary caries. Adhesion, problems of the adhesion, causing fracture of the restoration. So let's discuss clinically this, and then we got the idea. Many problems that we have on interface, we see that on composites, under composites, and this is infiltration pretty much, caused by a problem of the adaptation of the old composite. Let me tell you something that happens often in margin. The first problem that I can see that cause problems on margin adaptation, the first one, we are not too much accustomed to do finishing of the cavities, because we learned in the past that we have to do finishing for amalgam, but we didn't do that much for composite restorations. We learned that composite restoration, you don't need to do any prep. And also we learned that we have to keep the most structure possible, and we learn not to do too much finishing for composite restorations, and we have to do that. So this is the number one. Let me tell you one problem that happens often in the day-to-day. I am finishing a composite restoration. I'm doing myself. And now I am doing the selective enamel etching because it was newer. And then let me tell you something that after finishing the composite, I can see a white line. Many times we see these white lines in composites. Let me tell you that every time you see a white line in the interface of a composite restoration, every time you see that is a problem of a gap formation. Every time you see a white line on the margin of an anterior restoration or posterior means gap formation, means that this composite opened a gap, opened a space because of some problem. In this case, I can see this white line, and I know already, but I'm going to show you this white line under microscope. And then you can see that looking by far is okay. You can see composite, you can see the tooth, you can see the interface seems okay. But if you take a look very inside, you can see that you have 11 microns gap formation. 11 microns is impossible for you to fill with the explorer, but 11 microns interface you see as a white line. What is the problem of this gap? You can have some infiltration in the future, of course. But the problem usually is that when you have this type of gap formation, the patient goes home and he tells you after that he feels a little bit with cold. When he drinks something very cold or the air, he feels this sensitivity, this sharp pain with cold. That usually it goes away in 3 weeks because the composite expands a little bit, not that much, but you have this hygroscopic expansion of a composite. But of course, if this white line happens, you wanna seal that. You don't wanna wait. So the best stuff to do is you have to acid etch the interface, wash dry, and then you apply a very thin adhesive on the interface, you polymerize, and then you seal that. You solve, you promote a solution of that. So I felt that I had this problem. Was my problem. This white line was my problem, was an interface problem. And then I decided to do the sealing right after the restoration to avoid any problem. But I'm gonna tell you that perfectly is not. The best thing is to avoid the gap formation. And what is the best way to avoid it? We have to begin to pay more attention on the finishings of the margins of the cavities, especially for direct composite restoration that I'm discussing here. I use a lot this Pion-2 from WNH. There is an ultrasonic hand piece. And you have many tips, diamond tips, especially for finishing off margins. So let me show you how it works. This is a class 2 you can see before the finishing, and check the comparison of this class 2 cavity before the finishing of the ultrasonic device and after the finishing. you can see and you can feel that you have more quality of the margin after the use of this ultrasonic device. And then I'm able to restore the tooth. So check again, before, let's see. Let me show you before. Before the finishing of the margin, and check right now after the finishing of the margin. After the finishing, I can feel that the margin is much better. And the ultrasonic is very strong. Here, I'm just using ultrasonic for the students to understand that the ultrasonic nowadays, the piezo is very good. You can remove amalgam restoration using piezo. So piezo is very strong. So let me give you one example and then we finish this idea. This is class one, very simple. I will just do a finishing of the margin, seems almost like a bevel. And after I restore the tooth, I can see that after restoration, the margin is much perfect. It's much better than without a finishing. So the first tip that I gave to you in order to avoid marginal problems is pay more attention on the finishing of the margins. Can be ultrasonic handpiece, that is what I use. Of course, if you don't have that, you can use some diamond burr, finishing diamond burrs, but you have to do a finishing of the cavity. The second tip that I'm gonna give to you about adaptation on margin is, whenever you feel difficulty adapting a regular composite, use a flowable one. Add a flowable composite. You have books, you have like Douglas Terry book discussing just flowable composite. But let me tell you, until today, many dentists, they are afraid of using flowable composites. And the problem is that when you have a too consistent composite, it doesn't flow too much onto the cavity. You can see that this is a cervical margin of a class two restoration, class two composite restoration. You can see a bubble. This is a bubble. This is a space caused by the problem of the adaptation of the composite to the dentine margin. So pretty much I would say that whenever you have problems or difficulty or you're not sure that you are allow a very good adaptation, you have to add a flowable. The best technique for me is this one that we published last year in a paper for operative dentistry. And in this paper, we were comparing for class two restorations, many techniques to see what is the best adaptation on the cervical margin. So I was comparing the horizontal technique, the oblique, that is the traditional one, the Lutz technique, using bulk fill flowable composite, using the one that I'm gonna show you that is simultaneous, and using a bulk fill dual cure that we have in US. And I'm gonna show you the two best results, the two group that was not statistical different each other, between each other, is the simultaneous and the bulk flow dual cure. So let me tell you the technique that we use often in the day to day. If I'm restoring a tooth, I'm not sure that adaptation on the margin is gonna be super good, super perfect. For example, class two, I can put a little bit of a flowable composite, just a little bit, just almost like a wetting liquid, almost like a varnish, for instance, not too much, not too much. And on top of that, I condense or I adapt my composite without curing the flowable. So I just apply the flowable composite. I press the regular consistency composite on top of this flow. And this regular composite pushes the flow onto the interface, filling all these possible spaces that we could have. So pretty much the technique that we do nowadays, many clinicians, they by instinct, by feeling, they do as well. The matrix that I like the most for class two is this one. The name of this matrix is BioFit from BioClear. This is an American company. This is a very preformed matrix because you can see that adaptation on the lateral part of the matrix is better than the other ones. This is a transparent matrix. So I can follow adaptation of composite as well. The preformed shape of this matrix is very good. And this matrix is very thin as well. So as I told you before, just to remember again. Whenever you feel that it's difficult to adapt, put a flowable composite and press the regular consistency composite on top of that. This regular consistency composite will press the flow onto the possible or the future possible future failure that you could have. And then after finishing the interproximal cavity or the interproximal box, I remove the matrix, I remove everything, and then I restore as it was a class one. As I told you before, we discussed the traditional way to restore a class one, and this is pretty much discussed before. So this is just to give you the second tip, that is the use of flow. The third tip is we are so accustomed to condensed composite because we came from this amalgam training. And with amalgam, we should condense because amalgam was crystallization, remember that. And then when you adapt amalgam to the cavity, you should press with a lot of pressure. And then we came from this school of amalgam. And until today, many dentists, they think that they have to condense composite, and it's not. You have to avoid it. So every time you think about condensation, when you try to condense, and this is so true that many instruments for composite, they seem like a word condenser for composite. And every time you press a condenser, the composite comes back. And in the end, if you see very close in a microscope, or if you take a cut of the tooth, you see under the microscope, you're gonna see that you have some failures on the bottom of the cavity. So what is the best way to do instead of condensation? You have to promote just accommodation. That's why we use often burnishers. The burnisher that I told you is 2630 from Cosmedent and M1. If you don't find that, this is the condenser from the burnisher from LM. There is 1.5, 2.5 burnisher from LM. That is a European company. And then instead of condensing, you should just adapt. So imagine that you're passing the hand on your hair. Not Chris, because Chris doesn't have hair, but if you have a long hair, you pass the hand, you have to pass the hand strong, slide in the hand through the hair. So pretty much this is the movement that you do with the burnisher on top of composite, spreading the composite, making pressure without condensing. The fourth tip that I'm gonna tell you about this, about longevity of restoration, is try to avoid the use of diamond burr after restoration. So many dentists, they are accustomed to use diamond burrs, finishing diamond burrs in order to do the finishing of the restoration. And instead of that, I would recommend you to buy this one. This is from Comet. The name of this carbide burr is H379Q. And instead of like abrading composite and also the margin, this carbide burr will cut composite. And when this carbide burr touches the enamel, it doesn't abrade the enamel, slides on the enamel surface, avoiding any problem on the interface. Because many white lines and gap formation comes after the finishing, because we are frying the tooth. We are finishing too much. We are using too much diamond burrs in order to promote the sculpture and the finishing and polishing. And this is something that we have to avoid. This is the tip. Besides that, all these tips that I gave to you, the idea was mainly to avoid marginal problems. And I will give you one tip, that is to avoid fractures. There's pretty much related to adhesives. We are using adhesives, of course. I will not discuss too much adhesive. We are finishing the lecture already. But we have to understand that so far, many dentists still use too much these base lining materials under composite restorations. This also comes from the past. okay, I have four reasons for you to use more adhesives and try to avoid. I understand that many schools, they like GIC, glass ionomer, they use, we can discuss later on. But my four points are these. The first one, all the longevity evaluations that we find in, not all, but most of them, they show us that you have better results using just adhesive instead of using the sandwich technique that was glass ionomer plus composite. I'm gonna show you one review, systematic review, and then you can see this data. Check here, 5 years, 10 years, okay. Annual failure, 5 years, 10 years. Let's check just 5 years. Lining-based GIC present, 5 years, 2.2. No lining GIC present, 1.7. You know what it means? You have less failures using purely adhesive. Check in 10 years, lining GIC present, 2.7. No lining, 2.2. So this is the number one. And clinically speaking, this is something that we feel also. The second thing is, if you use too much lining and bases, you are too much accustomed to that, you're gonna see that composite is not resilient as we think. We think that composite is resilient, ceramic is stiff, and it's not true. Composite is stiff as well. If you make a bar of composite, you make a strain, you break, so it is stiff. And every time you put a stiff material on top of another material that is not that stiff, for instance, composite on top of GIC, what happens? The composite begins to deflect, and these often results in fractures or open interfaces. So this is one example. You see this interface that it seems like infiltration, and this is enamel margin. Man, we know enamel etching since forever. Enamel etching doesn't fail. We don't have failure on enamel etching. And then you can see that you have failure interface. What is this? You know what it is? The restoration is working on top of this too much GIC base, because in the past we used to work too much with lining and base. So composite is moving and is opening the margin. This is number two. Number three, you always have data about how much is the bonding strength of composite. And Pascal always shows us a good comparison that he uses, that what is a very good result of bonding strength of a very good adhesive? You know what it means? It's like putting a guy with 70 kilograms in T3 or 3.5 millimeter squared. There's a lot. You know how much we have coming from GIC? We have around 4 to 7 megapascal. That is less, of course. What does it mean? You know what it means? If you use too much GIC, you are taking surface, denting surface that was able to be used for adhesive. And instead of that, you are using GIC. You are taking free surfaces that could be used to increase the bonding strength of the restoration. And this is something that sometimes we don't realize. This is number three. Number four, and just to end my thinking, is this. In this case, let me tell you something. Many professors, they did some researches with this kind of tooth for extraction. You know, they took many teeth like this that was indication for extraction. And these Japanese guys, you know what they did? They push a stain from the end of the root and they take a look at the denting surface with a microscope, an optical microscope, to see what parts of the denting were permeable to this stain for fuchsin. They were using fuchsin. And you know what did they realize? That all the denting surface were permeable. So they could see this stain coming from the end of the root. They were pushing by pressure. They could see this stain all over the denting surface, except two areas, the deeper parts of the cavity. And you know what it means? This deeper part of the cavities, they are already biologically sealed. And usually these are the parts that we still have this traditional thinking that we need to apply some calcium hydroxide, especially in the deeper parts. And most of these papers, basically, they show us that we are protecting exactly the surface that doesn't need protection anymore. And this is a vicious that we have from the past, because this is a vicious of teaching. So we have been taught like that. And this is something that we have to move from. So just to reveal, and then I finish with one clinical case, and then I know that Chris is upset because I'm delayed already. I told you that most of the problems comes in the first 5 years. If you don't have these problems, the trend of the composite restoration is to stay like that, okay? And the second thing that I told you is what are the most clinical problems that we find in the literature. I told you that was margin and fracture. And then after that, I gave you some tips in order to avoid problems of margin and avoid problems of fracture. So let me finish with one case and we go for discussion. Seems good. I think and I believe that we have to understand this from direct restorations, and we have been using composite restorations for indirect restorations as well. Many of these recipes we will be discussing in the book, but just for you to understand that we have been doing inlays onlays in the same appointment in the technique that we call semi-direct. And in this case, I will basically produce the composite restoration on top of a gypsum model. And I do myself with my direct composite restoration. And after that, I'm able to do the cementation. So we are been doing, and I agree, in Switzerland, they have been doing this for a long time. We have been doing our inlays and onlays. You can do that on top of a gypsum model. This is something that is very, very traditional. This is tetric prime, that is a direct composite. But also you can do this technique in a semi-direct technique that we are able to reproduce or to reconstruct this tooth on top of a silicone model instead of a gypsum. And this is pretty cool because at the same time that the patient is waiting for the restoration, we are able to produce this very fast model. So the setting time of this additional silicone for model is 2 minutes, 2 minutes and a half. So in 2 minutes and a half, you are able to produce onlays, and pretty much you are able to do the cementation in the same appointment. This is something that we have in mind as well. Just to finish the lecture, this is my grandmother. She passed out years ago, but there was this mindset coming from our grandparents that was, you don't have to present a very fancy, super fancy yard. You don't have to get like a super Instagram yard, but your yard has to be very well like treated. So you have to do small things, simple things very well. This mindset comes from our grandparents. So nowadays, I think that we are so paying so much attention on doing fancy stuff and very complex cases. Sometimes we are not paying attention anymore in doing well done small things. And I think that this is pretty much the number one. My grandfather, he used to do these bamboo instruments. I think that this mindset is pretty related to what we are discussing. I am talking to you about simple composite restorations, but man, you can do a very, very, very good, very well done, simple composite restoration. So I think that this is the final message. I have a very small video and then we go for discussions. I think that if we have time to do that, just... Thank you.
deixe me ir, preciso andar, vou por aí a procurar, sorrir pra não chorar. Deixa-me ir, preciso andar, vou por aí a procurar, sonrisa pra não chorar. Quero assistir o sol nascer, ver as águas do rio correr, ouvir os pássaros cantar. Eu quero nascer, quero, deixo, preciso, vou por aí e a pouco, subir pra não chorar. E se alguém por mim te perguntará, dile que vou a volver. El día en que yo me encuentre, yo quiero ver el amanecer, ver las aguas del río correr, escuchar los pájaros cantar. Yo quiero nacer, yo quiero vivir, déjame ir, preciso andar, por ahí a procurar, sonrisa para no llorar.
Ronaldo, I have to say thank you for this presentation. I really love your videos. It was really impressive. And I have two questions, very interesting question from one guy. He's asking, what about the lining with the light cure calcium hydroxide? Because if you have a very deep caries, there are many different ways what you put on the deep caries parts on the pulp. Do you put the liner? Do you put calcium hydroxide? Do you put the composite direct on it? How do you handle this one?
I tell you that we have this trend to use too much, but I would say that I use, of course I use. But I use especially in a case that I feel that I can have some pulpal exposure, or the cavity is so deep that probably I have, and I cannot see yet, but I have some pulpal exposure, then I use. But in the other cases, I don't use much. But I have to say that the adhesive that I use the most, I use a lot of the adhesives, but the one that I use the most is Clearfill. Meaning that we are not etching denting for the last more than 10 years right now. So I use calcium hydroxide in cases that I have exposure, or I consider that I can have pulpal exposure. And then I use calcium hydroxide, GIC, glass ionomer, a little bit on top of that composite. But in the other cases, not. But I don't etch denting, and I discuss a lot. I know that we have different trends for adhesives, but my thinking is that the best way for us to go for clinicians is self-etching adhesives, because denting etching is a topic that is too difficult for you to control from the clinical point of view. And you have a lot of probability to have failures, especially over-etching, infiltration of the adhesives. So whenever I think about self-etching, I consider self-etching, especially with the Curaroy one, I consider a more mild adhesive system from the biological point of view. That's why when you see the papers, I don't do that, of course, but when you see the papers in the past that they began to try to use adhesives for deep cavities, always the best results were coming from Clearfield. And this was pretty much because of their monomer. But until today, I think that the self-etching is a more mild adhesive. But answering the question, I just use calcium hydroxide in deeper cavities. I don't know. I think that is something that I agree. The credit that I do is that if you go to Latin America, for instance, okay, all the Latin America, you're gonna see that dental schools, they use until today too much like GIC and calcium hydroxide, even for medium depth cavities. And this is like, they are not changing, you know? Europe, they change already, Japan also. There is a good paper. I think that I show you a slide very fast talking about teaching of operative dentistry. This paper is very cool because you can see how operative dentistry has been taught in different countries. For instance, how is the teaching of calcium hydroxide as a liner? And then you can see the percentage that dental schools in Europe that they ask you to use in this type of cavity. You can compare to Latin America. In Latin America, you have more. This is a very good paper. It's just about teaching. But my critic is that sometimes I think that the dentist become too lazy about thinking on changing. But not so much Europe, I would say. I would say that this is more common in Latin America, especially. Okay, the use of lining and bases as a frequent procedure, custom procedure.
Okay, so I think it's a good idea to make it easier to use the self-etching adhesives, but do you think we get better results if we just etch the enamel? Because there are many papers saying that if we use to etch the enamel, the strength gets even more. Is it necessary or is it over?
So we have some papers in literature that they found good results on enamel, but you just have papers showing this result with Clearfuel, not with the other brands. I'm not saying that other brands, they don't work, but I'm saying that the results that you find, the data is more Clearfuel. And I use Clearfuel in the beginning just as a self-etching without acid in the clinic, you know, in my private clinic. And the result was pretty good also. So the Clearfuel works in prep enamel. Prep enamel means you use a burr before, or you sandblast, let's imagine. But in the non-prep enamel, you don't have too much good results, especially on sealing. If you do bonding strength, sometimes you have bonding strength, but the sealing of the interface is not that good. That's why you have more staining. So nowadays I have this protocol of etching the enamel before self-etching. But I know that if you prep the enamel, is a class one, class two, and you use Clearfuel, you could use just adhesive, because I did in the past. And we have data to support the use of Clearfuel in prep enamel without the acid. But as we have to teach and we have to standardize, I always say that, and it's better to do the selective etch, I think that the best way.
Okay, so this would be the next question. If you don't do composites, so you do veneers, for example, which is very difficult, very demanding. Do you also do your system the same, like if you're doing composite filling, because you stick this veneer with a composite on the tooth? So do you do it exactly the same as if you would do it with a composite filling?
Like no prep veneer, you mean?
No, if you do a veneer with a little prep and you have most parts of enamel, some parts of dentin exposed perhaps.
So I will say that anterior teeth, the biodynamic is different from posterior. I will say why. Because the strength to the tooth and to bone the interface in anterior teeth is different. So imagine that you have a molar and you are chewing and all this chewing forces are coming to the pulpal floor, the bonding surface, okay, in a wide area. And it's different from anteriorative. That's why you don't have so much adhesive problems in anteriorative than you have in posterior. And the second thing is that the dentin on anteriorative, the substrate is more homogeneous than posterior. Because usually posterior, you're gonna see parts of the dentin is, you have too much sclerosis because you remove a node restoration and then you had in the past calcium hydroxide. There's another part that is a very fresh dentin, and each part of these dentin gives you different results of bonding strength. So posterior teeth is always more challenging, meaning that in anterior teeth, I wouldn't have any problem doing total etch techniques. And many times in anterior teeth, if I have to use different adhesives, I'm very okay on using total etching techniques, but not in posterior teeth. So I feel that is different, the dynamic of anterior and posterior. So this question about anterior teeth, would you make the same approach? I would say that anterior teeth, I have this trend of going for total etching. If you have dentin and enamel, you have this mix of surfaces, you know, because I don't have problems in anterior teeth. So I have to really have a huge, huge technical failure, like leaving the acid for 2 minutes and you promote the mineralization too deep in order to infiltrate adhesive to have a problem. Posterior not. Posterior is too easy to have problems because substrate is too complex and you have too much surface in chewing forces, under chewing forces.
Okay.
I don't know, makes sense. Make sense to you? I don't know.
Yes, that definitely makes sense. But you know, you ask five doctors in a webinar and they have 7 answers for this. So
okay.
It's interesting to talk about this. And there's another good question. The question is, what should be the ideal finish line for composite cavity? You showed that you use the ultrasonic device if you go down, but what is the ideal finish line for you?
So it's kind of bevel. When I say bevel, people begin to do a bevel like a class 4 bevel, and it's not, you know, it's almost like a bevel. I will say that you have to cut the enamel rods that you have remaining in the interface. It's pretty much this. You can do that with a diamond finishing diamond bore in a low speed electric motor as well. But I like to use the ultrasonic device because this is something that we use also for prosthodontics, right? We do the finishing of the preps and you can feel that the quality of the finishing with ultrasonic is better. I don't know. I don't know if you like also, but for inlays only, I feel that it's pretty good for crowns, right?
Yeah.
It's very precise. I would recommend, yeah.
The mesial and distal parts from cavities for fillings or inlays are always prepped with ultrasonic because it's much easier to protect the neighboring tooth.
Yeah.
And it looks very smooth and clean and a clean, good surface. So I think it's the same like you.
You remember the first handpiece that Cavo did in the past, and they have these inserts that had the same shape of the tooth. What was the name?
They were called inserts.
Yeah. I think that was the beginning of the idea of finishing the interproximal cavity. Now we have these different tips, but if you see these tips, they came from this time. The idea of the finishing is similar still.
Yeah. There's another question for you. What is your opinion about fiber resin composite for direct restoration in severe destructed posterior tooth?
So I saw some papers on that because you have commercial brands that use fiber already. And I like the idea, but I would say, I don't feel that this is gonna be a turning point somehow for composite to be used in a wider cavity. Got it? I think that fiber is interesting and I like the idea, but it needs something else. I think that has to has to be related to polymerization. So my point is, okay, this is cool. Fiber is nice. But I still believe that the point has to be also, or even more important, the quality of the polymerization of our restoration. This is something that I think that the indirect composite restorations, they have an advantage. Because if you remember the first composite systems, always the advantage was not how much filler they have more than our composite. It was pretty much the quality of the polymerization of the composite. So I would rely on this from the research point of view. I would be very interested on this, how to increase polymerization, etc. That's why when we use in the past the isozit in the past, what was impressive was the polymerization process itself. That's why the composite had this clinical behavior that was pretty different from the direct composites. But my opinion about fiber resin, that is good. It's not bad. It's a good idea, but it's not the turning point. I think that is not the magic. The magic is not gonna happen. You know?
Okay, I have another question for you. This question for me. One of my best teachers, Giuseppe Alla Torin, is watching us. I don't know if you know him. I think he's one of the greatest dentists I know. And he taught me and he taught me that you should warm some of your composites because you have a better polymerization. Do you also do that in your office?
So this is interesting because I mentor a thesis here about heated composite, not for cementation, for restoration. And we tested the degree of conversion to see if the type of heating that we do in the clinic, you know, like the heaters, they are able to change a little bit the degree of conversion in FTIR. And it didn't actually too much. I agree that the heat is good, but the amount of heat that we generate with our heater so far was not enough to change the quality of polymerization of the composite. But the heat after polymerization, yeah, this is something that can be interesting. So we have the preheating, that is before restoration, you heat the composite to change the composite and then you polymerize, and you have the post-heat. The preheat so far didn't change much. The post-heat, yeah, the post-heat changes. But I am willing to see more types of heaters for composite. Many people think that I don't like to heat composite. Not that I don't like to heat composite. I heat composite, but I don't see the heated composite as a replacement for cement, you know? I don't see that. That's why people always say, that is against the heating. No, I'm not against the heating. I like the idea of heating, especially changing the manipulation of the material, and I'm willing to see more changes in order to know what is the temperature that we can increase that is able to increase polymerization rate without having problems to the pulp, you know? So I think that we're gonna have more research on that. So you have already some heaters that hit the cavity fill instead of you heat that outside and then you put on the syringe in order to apply in the mouth. So you come with the cavity, you heat that until you fill in the cavity. So we are facing already some changes. That is improvements. But I think that we're going to have even more improvements.
About what temperatures are we talking? Because if it gets too hot, doesn't it get a problem for the pulp?
Yeah. That's why I told you. So far, we are using 6 something.
Okay. Next.
6.8. So 6.8 doesn't change much polymerization rate. But let me tell you, for instance, imagine that my heater goes to 90 degrees. I don't know what happens with the pulp because 90 degrees is not transferred to the pulp. So I think that the research will begin to test this. We have a tester in Brazil, and we publish a systematic review on heated composite. But now we have a project that you measure the heat transfer to the pulp with different heaters, different temperatures. And then you can measure how much the heat inside the pulp increases. But it's never like 68 degrees coming from the heater. The pulp goes until increases like 2 degrees. There's a graph that you can see. I think that this is something that we're gonna see more results, and then we can affirm, maybe we can increase the temperature of composite a little bit more or not. It's safe, it's not safe. But this idea, I think that will increase, but we're gonna have some improvements still.
Okay. I had a lesson with Federico Ferraris, and it was a lesson about anterior.
He's my friend. I like
it. He's a friend of you, and Federico showed us that after using his etch, before he puts on the adhesive on the cavity, he rinses it with chlorhexidine. Do you also do that? Because that's a question from Keisha Sousa. She is asking, if no etch is used, do you clean the prep before you clear fill with chlorhexidine, for example? Do you use that?
I use the Concepsis scrub. It's chlorhexidine.
Okay.
It's chlorhexidine plus silicon carbide mix. It is a paste. It's a prophylaxis paste. But just to clean the surface after the prep, like to remove the rough, imagine the rough smear layer. Like the smear on that is loose. But basically, I think that some clinicians are afraid of using chlorhexidine before self-etching because they think that chlorhexidine could interfere in the bonding strength. They have this fear. But we did this test. We published 2 papers using chlorhexidine before self-etchings. So it's good. I use. It's okay. You can use.
Okay, there's a fitting question from Dennis. He's asking, does phosphoric acid remove the remnants of saliva contamination? I think if you use a rubber dam, you don't have the contamination, but does it work?
Organic content, let's say saliva is saliva, but doesn't come just saliva. I think there comes many things, organic contents with the saliva. And there are some of these contents that the phosphoric acid are not so efficient on removing. Let's say, for instance, you have saliva, but you have some plaque. Well, like you have carbohydrate also. You were eating something before. You know, different substrates together. Saliva itself, I agree, phosphoric acid is able to clean. But doesn't come just saliva. So I believe that, okay, rubber dam is a solution, but if you have contamination, sometimes you have to do prophylaxis before the phosphoric acid. My prophylaxis material of choice is Concepsis scrub, chlorhexidine plus an abrasive, a very thin abrasive. And then I do that before.
Okay. There's another question.
What do you think? But you can say what you think also.
No, that's okay. You're the teacher for today, not me. And there's a question from Natasha. She's asking you, do you brush at the end of a scalpering the composite?
If I brush in the end of the sculpture, like,
I think it means if you do the polishing, the finishing with the brush.
Ah, okay. So I'm going to tell her what I do. The first instrument that I use is that burr. It's H379Q carbide. After that, I do a mixing of a diamond polishing paste plus Johnson & Johnson oil. That is mineral oil, becomes more fluid. And then I apply this paste with a prophylaxis brush. regular prophylaxis brush, and it spread the paste also inside the sulcus. I wash, I dry, and after that, I use the last instrument. This last instrument can be the carbide brushes, like Jiffy brush or Astro brush, or can be some rods from EVE. There is a diamond polishing rubber just for high polishing that can be used in the end. But usually are three steps. The first is carbide. The second is the diamond paste plus oil. And the last one can be carbide brushes or a diamond silicone rod. Can be EVE, can be from Jota. They have these silicones to be used in the end.
Okay. That sounds good. And can I ask you another question? It's from Adamaya Nigam. What should be done in case of pulp exposure, direct and indirect, and how to restore it? How do you handle it if you have a pulp exposure when you're excavating a tooth?
Yeah, if you don't have, of course, if you had so much caries, you feel that you have exposure is one thing. Sometimes it's too late. But if I'm removing the caries and then I have a little bit of exposure, my procedure is the traditional way. Calcium hydroxide PA, calcium hydroxide liner, paste to paste, GIC, and then I restore with composite. And then you follow up the restoration. This is my procedure. For indirect, I would consider to keep a restoration before going to indirect. So I don't know what kind of indirect restoration he's asking, but let's say a circumstance like crown. If you have exposure prepping a crown, a huge only, from the clinical point of view, I would consider sometimes going to end. If you really want to do a conservative approach, you have to wait more time. You're not like, you cannot lose a ceramic crown or ceramic only, and then you have to do an endo excess on top of that. So you would have to wait a little bit more than the usual. But private clinic, many times when you have exposure and the cavity is too big, man, sometimes it's difficult. You have these two options, endo treatment, you restore. If you want to go to a conservative approach, you have to keep with a long-term provisional. This is what I want to do. Long-term provisional means composite as well. Can be composite. Can be a CAD-CAM acrylic PMMA. But I will consider to keep this long-term provisional before going to ceramic.
Okay. So one more question. And I think this is a part of a question from Sebastian Davila. You were talking about that we made some artistic movements to do anterior and posterior restorations in earlier days. And you said that you tried to make it easier. And for example, there's one new material. It's called Omnichroma from Tokoyama. And they say many colors in one paste. Do you think this is a real alternative for the characterization of anterior teeth for the long-term run? Or do we have to go on and putting many different materials one after the other to have a nice aesthetic outcome?
So let me give you my background. I came from Brazil. So I come from Curitiba. There is a Newton Falls city. So we had a lot of influence coming from him because he was very, very like creative since the beginning. It was 95. And I learned to do many layers. The beginning of our dentistry in Brazil was this view of using too much composite. We used to work a lot with composite and with a lot of composites. And we have this view of this artistic restorations and stuff. What I noticed years after is that this was something that few clinicians, they were able to do, but most of them not. Even when they were going to courses and trainings, they still have difficulties. I felt that. And then all the industry began to feel the same. That's why we saw these changes and simplification on systems. For instance, Essentia, Miris too, etc. So it's not that I like easier things, but I like the idea of at least 80% of the clinicians being able to do something that I teach. If I teach something and I am a good professor, but I teach something that just 20% of the clinicians are able to do, 15%. So I have to find a solution. This is my point of view. This is my background. But now, talking about Omnichroma. Omnichroma was the first universal composite. And the problem of that, the idea was very cool. But the problem, and we published in the, I think that we published in the Journal of Aesthetic and Restorative Dentistry, okay? I don't remember very much, but I think that was. We published a paper comparing different universal composites because Omnichroma, the problem of Omnichroma that usually after restoration, the composite was gray or grayish with the value too low. So I think that most of the clinicians, they felt the same. That Omnichroma always becomes like dark, like gray, you know? And I began to test Omnichroma versus other universal composites. And then I began to feel that universal composite from 3M, for instance, the name is FieldTech Universal. That is just one shade, but okay, different shades, A1, A2, A3, but you don't have dentin enamel, you just have that composite. You feel the cavity. It's the approach of universal. I felt that FieldTech Universal, for instance, the result was very good. And we published this paper. So I'm gonna say, Omnichroma, personally speaking, I didn't feel that it's something that you can use in the day-to-day. The idea was cool, but the result not that good. But there are some universal composites coming that are interesting for everything, not for everything, for small cavities, especially like class 3, class 5. Something that you have to feel works. Instead of applying dentin enamel, can I use just A3, just A2? It works. It will work very well. So one example is FieldTech Universal. Second example is the, in Europe, I think that is Ceramex ST, SphereTech. They have the approach of Universal as well. The third composite that you're gonna have the same good results for this type of situation, cavities, is Tetric Prime. It's not universal, but they have the approach of a universal composite. So my answer is, I like the idea of the universal composites coming, not for everything, for cavities. But I don't believe that Omnichroma got these results. I think that was too low value restorations for us. It was too translucent yet.
Okay, Ronaldo, from my side, I have to thank you for your presentation because it has very good background from the point of view of literature. But I like your style, how you present, and I like your pictures. I like the way you do that. That was really nice, inspiring.
I told you about your hair, man.
This is a problem for me. I cannot do this because I have no hair. But this was really inspiring, and I see in the chat that there are many patients, many colleagues saying, "Oh, thank you very much. It was excellent tips and very good presentation." So from me, my side, thank you to you, and thank you for everybody who was watching us, and sorry that I could not answer all the questions together with Ronaldo. And I'd like to welcome you in 2 weeks, because Christian, I think the next time it's Udo Plaster.
No, next time we have Pascal.
It's Pascal Meunier. I think this is also a webinar you have to see. because this is really extraordinary that he's doing a webinar for us. And then 2 weeks later, it's Udo Plaster, and he's also one guy with absolutely great presentations. And I hope you have a good time and stay safe and stay healthy.
Yes, thank you very much, Ronaldo. Thank you, Chris, for taking the time all the way from New York. Thank you very much. It was exciting to watch, and I learn every time. So it's very good for me. I would also like to say thank you for the many welcome greetings from my side, because last time we were online, I showed you that I had a little accident. I'm doing well. So thank you very much for all the messages. We're looking forward to 2 weeks with Pascal, who also will introduce his new publication, which is long awaited after 10 years. So it's going to be very exciting. Ronaldo, Chris, thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
We will see each other, hopefully, in real life soon.
Ronaldo, when I come to New York, we have to go skating.
Les, but you are better than me. I'm like white belt.
Okay.
But let's go, let's go.
Let's go. Bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye. See you.